from Warsenal Studio B in Chandler, Arizona, this is MayaCast. Welcome to another edition of MayaCast. I'm your host, Tom Shadle.
And I'm your host, Kip Barcel.
And this is episode 155 for Friday, October 27th, 2017. Treason Wong Fu, thanks for the treason, Julie Pneumarch.
I like it.
We're going to finish off ITS Season 9 on today's show, going through the different missions after banging out those two super difficult ones last week. So we're going to try and finish that up today.
So long.
And that's all we're doing. So that's what's coming up on today's show. The last of our Season 9 data tracker shenanigan thoughts. But first, we have a couple new events to announce. And remember, you can check out all the upcoming events on the webpage, www.mayacast.com, in the show notes, where there'll be links to all the different events that are coming up. And the new ones, we start with an email from Matt Chafee. He says, hey, Ajax and Tucer.
That's so good.
He would like us to announce Colder Than Carbonite 2018 at the Wellington Park Community Hall in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada land. His words, not mine. February 9th through the 11th, 2018. Because if you're going to go to Canada, definitely go in February.
It seems like a good idea.
So soft cap of 30 of the chillest gamers ever to game games. And it's going to be a 5-round ITS featuring the missions Safe Area, Supplies, Transmission Matrix, Firefight, and Acquisition. It is a 300-point tournament with no spec ops, no space hobos, and no limited insertions. So Friday will be set up open gaming. Saturday, rounds 1 to 3, and then pub night. And then Sunday, rounds 4 and 5, with closing ceremonies and some super fun scenario thing.
Okay.
And so, yeah. So
that's exactly how it's written.
30 players may expand if needed, but the first 30 to sign up and pay will be guaranteed to walk away with some swag. It's only $30.
That's not bad.
Send that with your ITS number to carboniteinfinitytournament@gmail.com. And we'll have some kind of link in the show notes for you. Edmonton Infinity Gaming on there is their Facebook group for all your tournament update needs. So if you want to freeze your tookus off in Canada, or if you're already freezing your tookus off, go check that out in February in Edmonton.
I was going to say, when he said 30 of the chillest gamers, was that like literally you're going to be the chillest gamers around at that, because it's going to be cold?
Well, you know, I don't want to speak for him, but could be. Signs point to yes.
So the next tournament we have up to announce is, I was like, man, it is that time of year again. We have the Since We've No Place to Go. Arrow, arrow, arrow. And this is the third annual Chicagoland Holiday Infinity Tournament. Lunch will be provided, and all participants, that's not really easy for me to say, are encouraged to bring their favorite holiday dessert to share. So that could get interesting. The format is 300 points, two lists, and it's going to be standard ITS Special Operations Tournament.
Buckeye balls. Give me all the Buckeye balls.
three rounds featuring my throat being clogged, acquisition, capture and protect, and supplies.
Sorry, let me get that out of there.
Yeah. tournament rules says all standard tournament rules for the 300-point ITS tournament will apply. You can get those at the download section of Infinity the Game. They do have a ITS winner pack for the champion, but there will also be door prizes for the most festive and best painted army. If you're asking if there's spec ops, no. 24 players is their cap. It says, this will no doubt fill up quickly, so sign up ASAP. It's going to be on December 9th from 9:30 to 5:30, and it's going to be at the Lindsay's Gamer Garrison in Wakanda, Illinois. It's $15 to enter. If you're wondering how to sign up, Mr. Fetter says, just PayPal me at g_r_fetter, F-E-T-T-E-R, at hotmail. Come on, Grant. .com. And you have to register by Thanksgiving. We'll have that up in the notes, too. Is that stuck in your head now, Tom?
I was just providing a musical background.
Especially because I can't speak right now. For questions or an additional information, you can contact Grant Fetter via Facebook Messenger. Paint is not required, but all models must have their 180-degree markings on them or they will not be allowed. He does have one little note for you guys. And it says, there will be Beerfinity and other shenanigans the night before and the night of. So if you're coming from out of town, let him know so he can direct you toward the local accommodations.
Very nice. If you would like your event announced on the show, simply email all of the pertinent details, much like Matt and Grant did, to tom@myacast.com.
And kib@myacast.com.
And we'll read it on the show. We'll get it up in the show notes so people can find it. So, yeah. The show also could have been called Don't Be a Treason to South Central While Drinking Your Treason in the Treason. Anyway, before we get started with all the missions, I do want to remind everyone about MayaCast MasterGlass Q4 2017, the final one of the year, and a whole new
format,
a whole new outlook on life. Q4, we don't have restrictions. You don't have to paint a certain thing. You can do whatever you want, from a single miniature to an entire army to a diorama to a piece of terrain to whatever you want to do. You just have to fit the theme.
Mm-hmm. I was going to say, well, there's one rule.
And the theme for Q4 is fall. That's it. Just the one word. Interpret it however you want to apply it to Corvus Belli miniatures, and let's see what you come up with. 6 images per person maximum. You know what? There doesn't even have to be a before picture because, you know, you're doing something for the theme. So it's going to be new because you didn't know what the theme is.
That's very true.
Well, I had this brown model sitting around anyway. Well, yeah. If we've seen it on the internet before, we're going
to
disallow
it. Just don't share it on the internet. But that's kind of cool because then we don't have to be like, well, your before picture.
Yeah.
And then you're after.
Not so much.
Just after pictures.
So I can't wait to see what you come up with, Tor, and everyone else.
Schwanson.
Fall. That's all you get. Not heavy infantry, not tag, not just fall.
Although it can be a heavy infantry or a tag. But
right.
It's fall themed.
Yeah. However you want to interpret it. It's a verb, it's a noun, it's in
Clausewitz Oolong tripping over something.
Anyway, so yeah, fall. That's all you get. That's the theme. And of course, it is always a painting contest, but there'll definitely be points for creativity and how you fit the theme as well. So yeah, can't wait to see what you all come up with. I hope all of the gears are turning and churning and that we get a bunch of fun, funny, creative, and clever entries for Q4. Fall. So, yeah, that's the thing that's going on. And you can send those entries by the end of the year. Right? You've got until the end of 2017.
Man.
And you can send those entries to tom@myacast.com.
And kip@myacast.com.
And we will do the thing early next year. But, yeah, so you've got until the end of the year. But don't wait. Because we've got Thanksgiving and Christmas.
Yeah.
And you're going to get busy. And so, yeah, fall. Fall.
I like that.
However you want to interpret it. So let's finish off season 9 talking about the missions, starting with, if you would like to turn the appropriate page in your textbook, boys and girls, we're going to start with the grid.
Considerable damage and casualties.
Mission debrief.
So the grid. This is one of those 9 objective setup missions. Fun times. You have to designate them.
Mm-hmm.
Right, and that's using a specialist, using their willpower when they're in base to base, or
mm-hmm. Yeah, it's my favorite.
And part. You know, player A can flip it to player from B. A and B can flip, right? You can also designate them using the forward observer skill, which is a ranged attack at burst 2.
Yeah.
So you don't necessarily have to be all over the field and infiltrating specialist. And yeah, you can substitute the forward observer skill.
So you get laser tag.
You get 3 points if you designate more antennas, 2 points if you are tied on designated antennas. If you destroy more antennas, more antennas, you get 3 points, 2 if it's a tie. And you can only destroy them from the second round. Well, we'll talk about how to destroy them later.
Yeah.
Get through the points. You want to kill the enemy HVT because in this mission, it's a designated target. If you kill it with your data tracker, that's an additional 2 points. So your data tracker is worth 2 points. Your enemy's data tracker is worth 2 points. Keep that in mind as well.
Mm-hmm.
There are no classified objectives. You do not use the deck.
That's fun. It's kind of like a straightforward thing.
The center 20 inches of the table is a thicket. And that's a saturation zone. So everybody be -1 burst. Shooting into, out of, or through the center 20 inches of the table.
Ugh.
You know how we were talking about on previous Treason episodes?
Hmm.
Their wording, where they're like, the 8 inches on either side of the center line.
Mm-hmm.
Well, when you say either side, like, that could be both sides, or that could be the 8 inches that is centered on
that's
the,
what you're saying.
Right? Because it's not a very specific term, it's more colloquial. And so I went to the Spanish version and copied and pasted that into Google Translate. And instead of either, it comes up with the word both.
Oh.
So when it says the 10 inches on either side of the center line or the 8 inches on either side of the center, it's both. The 8 inches on both sides of the center line. So it's the center 20 inches is that saturation zone -1 burst. You have 12-inch deployment zones.
Mm-hmm.
And it'll end after 3 rounds or if somebody goes into retreat. We already talked about designating the antennas.
Mm-hmm.
To destroy the antennas, you can only do that starting in the second round, and you must first designate it. So you can designate them in the first round, but you can't destroy them until round 2, and it must be your designation.
Yeah, not the opponent's, right?
If you're player A and player B has one designated, you can't destroy his.
Yeah.
You must designate it for yourself first. Once they are destroyed, they still count as having been designated by you. That's a question that came up, like, well, if I destroy it, it doesn't exist, so did I not designate it? No, so you got to keep track of, you got to leave your A and B out there so you keep track of how many you designated and how many you destroyed. Mm-hmm. You cannot accidentally hurt an antenna that is not designated, nor can you accidentally hurt an antenna before round 2.
So no, like, shotgunning this one, but the blast goes across, or
no,
like shooting a guy and then the template hurts the.
No. Nope. While they are damaged and not destroyed, you may still flip them from A to B.
You can still
designate them while they are damaged. That is a clarification in the forums from Heloise. So, it's got to be completely destroyed to count as destroyed.
So it's like on your last turn, you cause only one wound. You're like, oh no, and they go and just flip it from you.
They can not only redesignate it, but then they're that much closer to destroying it.
Exactly.
Because it's a scenery structure, only anti-material is going to be able to damage these antennas. And these antennas are armor 4 and BTS 3, and they do have 2 structure.
Yeah, they're not easy.
So anti-material are double action, explosive, K1.
K1, I still can't believe what that is. That's insane.
Just check your traits for anti-material. Mm-hmm. So all the multis will have, like, an anti-material version. It's usually mm-hmm. burst one, though. There's no stipulation in this one, like the other mission, where you have to damage it in close combat, like the AC-2s,
mm-hmm.
right? There is no stipulation, so you can shoot it. You can fire missiles at it, or your HRMC on anti-material mode, right?
Mm-hmm.
What a waste of burst. Anyway, yeah, so you can shoot them. You can forward observe them, and you can shoot them.
Oh, man.
So, yeah. That's the mission in a nutshell as far as the logistics of it go.
It's just, I wrote down in big letters, it's laser tag. Because it's like, you know, everybody's bringing the forward observers out. Makes things a lot easier. Do you remember the saturation zone, though? Because you're like, yeah, I get burst two. Most of the ones that are in the middle, if you're shooting across the table, mm-hmm. you only get burst one. I think that the ones that are on your side of the table, you wouldn't take that if you're shooting out of your deployment zone, right?
No, because the thicket's 20 inches, right? So mm-hmm. 10 inches on either side, which means 14, and they're up at 16 inches. So yeah, they're in it.
Okay, so that's kind of cool. But
I wonder if the thicket was added after they're like, yeah, let's let forward observers laser tag them.
Yeah.
All right, let's do it, yeah, but let's make it, yeah.
Man, those, oh, but the, so, like I'm like all, let's take forward observers and then all the mm-hmm. anti-material that you can fit. This is good for, you know, certain factions like K1. I totally forgot that was. Then you get burst three. Knocks them down to armor zero. Then you have to beat a 12. That's kind of nice.
Just got to beat a 12.
I think all T2 weaponry is anti-material. So that's kind of nice for...
Any what is?
Caledonia. T2.
Oh, T2?
So like T2 rifles, T2 snipers. They're all... Hopefully they lose one, and then it's both structure points. Yeah, I actually haven't got to play this, and I want to now. It seems like a really extremely fun mission because you don't have to take all the infiltrating, you know, specialists to try to push the buttons. It's you're literally playing laser tag and then trying to kill your other opponents and targets.
Sure, and that's the hard stuff. But four of your points, 40% of the scoring comes from mm-hmm. killing the HVT and making sure it's your data tracker that does it. And we had the grid before. We had it in tagline. But now we add in the data tracker, and the HVT is a hostile designated target.
Mm-hmm.
So what I find really enticing for this mission is to take a big man boss kind of specialist guy mm-hmm. who is, you know, he can designate on its way to the enemy HVT, right?
Okay. So,
he can bop into base contact, or if he's a forward observer, he can, mm-hmm. you know, forward observe them along his way as he's making his way to the HVT. He's got to be beefy enough to make it there.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever form of protection you choose, be that friends with smoke or ODD mm-hmm. or high armor or whatever. Now, of course, on the other side, you want to keep your HVT out of line of fire. From the enemy as much as possible
mm-hmm.
While following the deployment rules for HVT, but also keeping it sort of out of line of fire of the antennas as well. So like they're not
good point
just to make it, you know, that one extra order harder or mm-hmm. right. So they can't like, I'm going to walk up to this beacon and I'm going to shoot your HVT and I'm going to touch the button. I'm going to shoot your HVT again. Cause I missed the first time, like mm-hmm. whatever it like, make them go around that corner, get away, because they're 9 antennas, they're all over the place. So find an inconvenient place to put your HVT where they can't sort of just camp in cover and get a whole bunch of things done mm-hmm. at one time. If you're deploying second, enemy HVT is on the table.
Yeah, that's nice.
So you can pick a data tracker that can favorably deploy near it. Get to it easily, make the assassination easily. So there's There's a choice to be made here.
Yeah, I was there's just no, going to say that.
There's no right answer, right?
Nope.
There's I will probably, if I win, mm-hmm. I'm probably choosing to deploy, have you deploy first. And then let you make the decision on whether you go first or second. If you go first, you can run around and you get the first opportunity to flip and destroy antennas. And if you destroy mm-hmm. it before your enemy does, well, then you deny them the opportunity to designate it and mm-hmm. flip it. Now, you can't destroy until turn two, right?
Yeah, but then you get first dibs on the destructions.
But if you go second, you can flip all the ones your opponent just flipped and make him do it all over again before he can blow stuff up.
True.
So...
Which is annoying.
If you go first, you could assassinate specialists, not let him designate, like ignore mm-hmm. the mission for a turn. And assassinate a specialist, kill his HVT.
Mm-hmm.
Make sure you get those 4 points for killing it with your data tracker. And kill as many specialists as you can. Mm-hmm. And wait till turn two or three to designate.
That is actually what I wrote down if you're going first because of that reason. Wrote down, like, if you're going first, I think that I'm playing... kill their specialists and go after the HVT and not even worry about the antennas
mm-hmm.
because it's not going to matter until the end of the game. And like you said, why waste orders on stuff that they're just going to flip back anyway?
Yep.
So F it. If I'm going first, I'm killing things.
It can be frustratingly difficult to destroy these Structure 2 Armor 4 antennas
mm-hmm.
and expect to spend more orders. Like, don't expect, like, okay, I'm going to take one missile launcher shot at it and then I'm going to destroy it. And now, right?
I'm going to start making armor rolls.
And you look at the orders you have left, you're like, okay, I'll use one to missile launch, then I'll use one to do this, then, right?
Mm-hmm.
No. Twice as many as you think, right?
Mm-hmm.
Burst one, you're going to miss. It's going to make armor rolls, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just expect it to take more orders than you think when you're planning out, like, the end of your turn.
Mm-hmm. Smart.
And I think that's my main point about this mission, or my main thought that I had was, you really want a lot of orders here.
Mm-hmm.
There's so much, you got to push all the buttons or forward observe all the things. Then you've got to get anti-material weaponry to them, deliver that to blow them up, whether it's D-charges or close combat weapons, or mm-hmm. you're firing missile launchers. K1 combi, like we said, probably the best because it's burst three.
Yeah, and it knocks it down to armor zero.
Yeah, it's just got to be to 12.
Mm-hmm.
And, but yeah, orders, like so many ITS missions, orders are really king. Because there is a lot to do. Now, when you think about the mission objectives, okay, so you've got to designate more and destroy more.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you kill all their specialists, all you need to do in turn three is designate one and destroy one.
Yeah.
And if they are unable to designate, they can also then not destroy. So you could definitely ignore, like, your initial thought is, okay, I got to get more. I'm going to go push all the buttons. I'm going to push all 9 buttons. All 9 of them. Or you could just waylace your enemy, make sure you kill every single specialist that he has, and then you only need to get one on your final turn.
Mm-hmm.
And then he reveals the hidden deployment specialist that you could never touch.
Yeah. That's what I was going to say. That's what I like about going second, if you have that option available to you. Like the hidden FOs.
Mm-hmm.
Those are probably my favorite my favorite on this, and I would want to go second if I had those, because then they're never touched. And then...
So if you win the roll, are you choosing to go second?
Nope. Well, so... It all depends on what, like, how you're going to play it. It's A, going to depend on terrain, and then B, what your opponent gives you in their deployment. But I think that I agree with you.
No. If you win the roll, not what your opponent gives you. If you win the roll.
I'm choosing table side and choosing to deploy second.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think I do that every time on this. The only thing that...
Because there's 4 points right there with the HVT.
Yep.
And if you deploy... If you make him deploy first, you know exactly where that HVT is.
And then you can counter deploy.
You can put your stuff there to go and get it.
The only thing that scares me about that is certain armies. So if I'm playing against Vanilla Combined or Vanilla Hawk or Hisasins, so a lot of times that I'm like, I want first turn because I'm going to have Speculos in freaking, what are those?
Fides
all up on my business. And going second, when that's in front of you, puts you at a disadvantage, even if you do get to counter deploy them. So I think that the majority of the time I'm going to pick table side and go have them deploy first. But against those two armies, I tend to lean towards going first so that they can't just turn one, use those to take out a bunch of my specialists or put me in a really hard position.
See, I think you can, you've played long enough that you can effectively deploy where if the Fide bomb goes off or the Speculo goes off, it'll kill one thing, but then die.
Because
you have a ton of AROs. And if you choose to go first in fear of a Combined Army player may have a Speculo.
And then they never drop it.
Or a Hawk player might have a Fide.
Mm-hmm.
And now you've chosen to go first because you fear this one model. Well, let them go first and use it and die on that first order because you overwatched it. Because you got to choose... You got to force them to deploy first. So you know where it's going to be.
Mm-hmm.
You know to expect... You're already expecting it. That's why you considered taking first turn. Mm-hmm. But... and they may want second turn on a mission that scores at the end like this. So you may get...
True.
You may get both benefits, right?
Mm-hmm.
You see the deployment and you get to go second. Get to go first.
Mm-hmm.
So you're going to see it. You know, you're deploying, expecting it anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So all of your dudes have buddies. And then you've got... He's going to place his reserve model before you. So if you need to, your reserve model can go down to make sure that that impersonation marker, should it try anything on turn one, is definitely toast after it kills mm-hmm. the one thing that it's going to kill. Also, his HVT is out.
Mm-hmm.
It's the biggest advantage. It's 40% of your scoring, right? There's no telling what happens in the rest of the mission as normal, but you have the advantage of seeing where that HVT is and deploying in a place where you can kill it right away.
Quickly.
With your data tracker before your data tracker mm-hmm. dies, as long as you have an appropriate model,
mm-hmm.
Infiltrator, impersonator, right? And you,
yeah, because like, you do the data tracker after everything's deployed. So even after
yep.
there. Yeah, so. Yeah, that's a fair point. I just have had... Maybe it's just because most of the time when I choose, like, table side... And this is all this Hawk scaredness is because it's coming from playing Lewis. So maybe it's not the fact that Fides are there. It's just that I get smoked by Lewis a lot.
His Fides never do anything about
I'll give you that, because that's like the only time that I kind of really have a problem with is with Hawk on whether I want to deploy first or go first. But I do agree with you on a mission like this where four points.
Yeah, if
I would rather take deployment and then just let my opponent have the hard decision.
There's advantages to going first and to going second.
Yep.
Going first, you get to blow stuff up first. Going second, you know exactly where and how you need to move to counter what your enemy did to make sure you score. So there's advantages to both sides of first and second, but there is a clear advantage to deploying second.
Yeah.
And that's what I want every time in this mission. If I win, I'm choosing side, making him deploy first. Absolutely, every time.
So here's a good question
for
you.
Don't care what the army is.
So if your opponent does this and they choose deployment, you deploy first. Now do you go, well, I have to take first turn. Because if I take second turn to get the advantage of the buttons, giving them first, my designated target's done.
That'll,
it's gone. No,
that'll greatly depend on my army.
Okay.
So... what if my army has no infiltrating specialist?
Mm-hmm.
Right? So I've got nothing to assassinate his with, and I've got nothing to protect mine with. You know, I'll put her in a place where she's covered by Overwatch.
Mm-hmm.
Because you deploy her, like, okay, so I know my link team, my defensive link team is going to go up here with my HMGs and my sniper rifles.
Mm-hmm.
And they can see this behind this building here, where he's got to come around one side or the other to even get to the HVT. So that's where we're going to put the HVT, right in line of fire on my dudes, who can also cover this, you know, cover all these objectives over here. Yeah, you set up defensively, because maybe you don't have to defend her from right next to her. Her being the HVT, by the way.
Oh, yeah, because we always use females.
Yep.
Both of us.
I have the office lady. CSU, machine gun briefcase.
And since she's painted, I always use Go-Go, just because she's painted. It's the only HVT I have.
We say it every episode. They're tired of it. Yeah. But, yeah. So, yes, if they choose side and make me deploy first, cool. I can do that and set up defensively.
Mm-hmm.
But then choosing whether to go first or second totally depends on my army. If I've built an AR, like an army that's very strong in ARO, mm-hmm. A very defensive one, like you like to play those defensive link teams, then I will if I've got Morans with crazy koalas that can, mess up the whole middle of the board there, mm-hmm. And do a board control thing, maybe I will choose to go second because I want him to come into my ARO and I want him to come into my mine layered mines, mm-hmm. and my crazy koalas and all that kind of stuff. If I've got a very alpha strikey kind of army, if I've got Speculo and I've got Raziad or Kodali, right? And mm-hmm. I'm gonna be super aggressive.
Something that can take their specialists, all the specialists out really yep. quickly. Yeah. No, I agree with you on that.
And admit,
I just know that there's people out there who probably ask that. Well, what if mm-hmm. I don't win the role?
For sure.
Because that's what you're faced with. And I agree with you. It is all how you built your army out, like how it's going to flow.
Yeah, and so you ask yourself the question, if I go first, what can I do? Am I able to murder a specialist? Not really. I kind of want his specialist to walk out towards the objectives so that I can kill them. Mm-hmm. So I do want to go second so that mm-hmm. My ARO force is at its full strength on his first turn. It's just, yeah, it totally depends on army construction at that point. That's and possibly point. Table.
Oh, yeah. Because, if you have no fire lanes to set up defensively and there's a lot of cautious movement that they could get to no matter where you're at, then might as well go first and try to take their orders out. Ironically, the list I played on Monday that I wanted to try for the first time with the two fire team options in U.S. Ariadna, I would take first turn because there's not a lot of defense. There's a little defense, but it's actually two offensive fire teams that you have to switch back and forth. And I had to switch back and forth one time. It was awesome. Good times.
So, yeah, K1 Combi, Autocannon, Multi-Sniper, Feuerbach are anti-material things with more than Burst 1.
T2 rifles as well.
As long as you're 100% sure that T2 is...
Yep, I actually pulled up the weapons chart while we were talking. Because I strictly for that, because I couldn't remember if they were or not, because I haven't played with it a lot. But yeah, T2 boarding shotguns are anti-material. T2 rifles. T2 sniper rifles. Tac bows.
Ooh, and at 16 and 24, on a 40mm base...
Mm-hmm.
With an 8.25-inch shotgun template, if you have two designated in a row, that the T2 boarding shotgun
mm-hmm.
could blast two of them in one shot.
Yeah, because they're only 8 inches across away from each other.
Yeah, one's at the 24-inch mark, one's at the 16-inch mark, but that's the center of them, and they're 40mm each.
Yeah, so you could, if you designated both, yep. you could hit them in one shot.
Especially if you're not, if you're not shooting it like in a straight line, mm-hmm. but you're up near the front of one marker where it's going to blast back into the next marker.
What's good with that too, with it being saturation zone. If you can do that with a offensive fire team, then you still get burst two.
Yeah,
that's what I kind of like. That's what I was thinking of.
And is there a T2 boarding shotgun option that's linkable?
Yeah, in the Highlander Grays.
There you go. So
so for Caledonia players, it's speaking strictly at you. But yeah, man, that's awesome. I don't think regular boardings are, though.
No, they're just regular. They're normal ammo.
I don't know if their AP allowed them to.
Well, AP's not.
Nope. It's not. Dang, man. T2's awesome then. If you're Caledonia. Because the only thing like US has in it is the blackjack sniper.
Well.
That I can think of off the top of my head.
Yep. Yeah, so, cool. Grid, good?
Yeah. I never played it last season. And I haven't played it this season.
I did. I think it was Lewis's favorite game against me.
So do you like it better with the data tracker?
I have to ask him about those free models you got in the tagline version. What?
Because didn't in the old one, wasn't it like classifieds and stuff?
Yeah,
and
data tracker didn't exist. Mm. I don't know. I have not tried it. I have not tried it yet in the new style with the data tracker.
In theory, that was one of the things I liked the most about the change since I've never played it. But it's like it kind of makes it more straightforward. Instead of being like, well, I have to do these secret things. Now it's like, boom, this is what you do.
Mm-hmm.
So,
all right. So comm center, another one of these 9 objective grid things again, changed since last year. Cause there's going to be a data tracker.
Mm-hmm.
There's an exclusion zone, Kip.
I don't forget those that often.
So no, AD, no mechanized, mm-hmm. no infiltration, no impersonators within that center 16 inches of the board. You do have 12-inch deployment zones like normal.
Mm-hmm.
You want to connect more antennas
mm-hmm.
than your opponent. You get 4 points for that. If you do the same number, you both get 2. If you kill more specialists than the enemy, you get 2 points. Again, it's a designated target. So that's worth a point if you kill it.
Mm-hmm.
Designated target instead of HVT, right? And if you kill it with your data tracker, that's a bonus of +2. So it's only 1 for killing it, but doing it with the data tracker makes that a 3-point objective. Not quite as impressive as the grid's 4-point objective,
no.
But the same exact thing and the same comments will apply.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have 1 classified worth 1 point. It's worth noting that the description does not have you remove the HVT cards. So you're going to find some very odd interactions where you have a classified involving the HVT and the HVT is hostile. And you're like, no, I just want to put this syringe in your thigh. No, I'm going to shoot you. So you have a hostile ARO-ing HVT that you must be much more careful about getting to perform any of the HVT classified.
That is crazy because yep. It's like it kind of makes for a funny scenario. It's like you were saying you want a doctor. It's like I want to shoot you with my med kit and hopefully I got shot back and then I'm gonna shoot you after that because I need to kill you too.
Yep.
It's like come on. Oh,
or I'm gonna shoot you with something burst 1 so that you're just unconscious so I can still.
Oh, that very true.
Do the
knock him out. Throw this drug in it. Let's see how she reacts when she wakes up.
So you need a specialist to do the antenna thing, and you can flip them from player A to player B. It's a normal whip roll. Third round will end the game, or if somebody starts their turn in retreat, it'll end the end of that turn. Like I said, the comments on the data tracker and the designated target remain exactly the same as the grid.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's the exact same scenario. Kill the designated target. Kill it with your data tracker. So, if you get to go second,
mm-hmm.
you get the end game flipping of consoles, right? It's like, oh, he's got 5. I have 4.
Mm-hmm.
So I need to flip one of his, and then I'll have 5, and he'll have 4. So you know exactly what you need to do if you're going second. That can be very, very powerful.
Mm-hmm.
But that probably also means you're deploying first. Whereas if you deploy second, you have access to the enemy HVT for those 3 mm-hmm. points. You can assassinate all their specialists. Well, as many as you can.
Mm-hmm.
You can... right, so it's the same conundrum as last time.
Mm-hmm.
You want all the specialists in this mission, but... Yeah. You want to balance that with the fact that if they kill more than you kill, like you're giving your opponent more opportunity, right?
Yeah, that's
so.
That's the hard part is because you got to keep them alive.
So, like mobile ones are good, like the forward observer bots.
Yeah.
6-4 move.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's an exclusion zone, so you're not starting right up on the objectives. And you can't just forward observe these. Like, you've actually got to go up to them and push the button.
Yeah, no.
No laser range. Tag in this one. So maybe you want, like, a big, beefy specialist, like that Hacktow Hacker, or the Anathematic, or Swiss Guard, right? Where you have less specialists. So, yes, if it goes down... they've only killed one specialist, where you might kill, you know, multiple Al-Hawaz and Hunzikuts and Farzans and all that kind of junk, right?
Yeah, that's what I mean. It's worth 2 points.
So, yeah, maybe a bigger, beefier, more resilient specialist to give them less opportunity to kill more than you did.
I think I like that, and I also like... even if you can't use their infiltration, I like the camo or hidden deployed specialists comboed with the beefy one, because then they're not on the table. Mm-hmm. Like maybe one or two. Or if they are, they're camoed, so it's not like they can just be outed right away.
Just leave it for turn bottom of three, and you're like, I'm going to reveal.
Mm-hmm.
Spin an order off the table to move a marker that wasn't on the table.
Mm-hmm.
And then bleep, boop, bleep, bloop. Last turn heroics on turn two.
Yeah, I think that finding the healthy balance of what your army can provide in hefty specialists, but not taking 9 or 10, you know, like say you're running a 15 order list. You're like, well, I got 9 specialists. Your opponent has 4, but they're mobile and they're beefy and they're hard to kill. And yours are all like 1 armor. And I kind of like that approach a little bit better on this.
Or if you can get it, like, here's my Anathematic Hacker.
Yeah.
And that's the only one you know about.
Yeah.
And then a Malignos can pop out in turn 3.
Mm-hmm. Or turn 2 if you need it.
Right, but, and there's only 2 in the list.
Mm-hmm.
Because you know you're going to have that one for your final turn.
Mm-hmm.
At least, and it's not easy to kill an Anathematic.
No.
Again, if you get to go first, maybe don't connect any consoles. Kill their specialists, but like advance to the midfield, because you're not starting there anymore, right?
Nope.
Because there's exclusion zone. So advance to the midfield, lay all of your mines, put all your dudes in suppression, and now they've got to come to push the buttons. But now all of a sudden you've set up all your stuff there to be like, okay, jerk, come out from behind those buildings and see what we got for you. And they've got to spend so many orders dealing with all that stuff. Like, okay, well, I've got to get rid of that guy in suppression fire. So I got to move in such a way where he's the only one I can see. Now I remove him. Okay, I got to discover this mine. Okay, discover the mine. Now I got to get rid of the mine, minesweeper it, or shoot it off the table. Like, just make him waste all of his order, and all of a sudden turn one's over. He's taken away half of your stuff in the midfield. Now your wave two advances. You make him do it all over again, and then, you know, turn three, you grab your objectives, and hopefully he's whittled down so much and he's wasted so many of his orders that there's not much left for him to be able to do on turn 3. But yeah, I think if I'm going first, I'm ignoring all the objectives.
I kind of agree with you, because you need to protect them.
Instead, I'm just mining up and suppressing up and all that good stuff.
I would just say, like, it's always army-dependent, like what you're playing, using the tools at hand to most effectively cover, like you said, cover the center, and hopefully you have one or two that can go specialist hunting, you know, like an AD troop or a fast-moving heavy machine gun.
So you can still walk in that 4-inch dead zone between the deployment zone and the exclusion zone.
And then there's that one awesome guy that can come in anywhere on that side of the table. But
that one person.
Yeah, that one person.
And Zant.
But yeah, like that 4-inch strip, so, which is easy to cover. So a lot of times you might not get it. So you might be making that roll.
A lot of those The first and second player comments and the first and second deployment comments and the data tracker comments, it's all the same as as the previous mission. Just, you don't need to bring as much Anna material.
Nope. Like, don't have to worry about it at all.
Rescue!
Everybody's favorite.
Yeah, see, this, we remember from last year, you got to go sync up with the civilians that are just inside the difficult terrain zone, which is good news because they don't stop, right? It's difficult, not very difficult, so they can just move as normal. You getting there, on the other hand, is another story. You have different zones in this mission, right? There's the exclusion zone, which is that center 16 inches. There are the dead zones. That's the 4-inch strip in between the exclusion zone and your deployment zone. Then you have your deployment zones. So first you need to understand your zones to understand how it scores. You want to have more civilians in the civivac state, which, you know, you sync them up, one of your dudes, in the exclusion zone than your opponent. That's worth a point.
Yay, one.
You want to have more civilians in your own dead zone, the foreign strip, than the opponent has in their own dead zone. Right? That's going to be worth 3 points. If you both have the same number of civilians in the dead zones, it's 2 points each for a tie. You also want to do that with your deployment zone. Have more than your opponent, you get 3 points. If you have more civilians in your deployment zone than he has in his, 0 points if you tie. So that's definitely a more. And then have one civilian in civivac state with your data tracker. That's worth 1 point if it's in your dead zone.
2 points.
Or 2 points if it's in your deployment zone. You can score one, but not both of those because of the way math works. Even though specialists are allowed to sync with two civilians, your data tracker could certainly be a specialist. It could certainly be synced with two civilians. One could be in the dead zone and one could be in the deployment zone. But you're only going to get the higher point one for the deployment zone. You're not going to get both of those points, the one and the two. Because otherwise, the mission's going to add up to 11 because you also, if that wasn't enough to do, you also have one classified worth 1 point. Right? So that exclusion zone, not only is it an exclusion zone, Kip.
It's muddy.
It's a saturation zone, so minus one burst. And it's difficult terrain. It's
super muddy.
So difficult terrain, if you get to the edge of a difficult terrain area, you must stop. And then you only get to use your, is it your second movement mount?
Second movement mount, yeah. So, like, you can move, but every time you move, you have to use your second movement value.
So for a lot of things, it doesn't matter, right? A lot of things are 4-4. But for things like an Umbra
that are 6-2...
that stinks, right?
Or grunts that are 4-2. Or a lot of medium, most medium infantry is 4-2.
Right.
No bueno.
But if you have any kind of terrain skill or multi-terrain, then you can ignore the effects of difficult terrain. You don't have to stop when you get to the edge of it, when entering it, right? It doesn't say anything about stopping when you leave it, so you can leave it just fine. But you don't have to stop at the edge of it when you enter it. You don't have to take the movement penalty. So you want things that can grab specialists that have multi-terrain or jungle terrain or desert terrain or whatever.
I like that it's any terrain type.
Yep.
That makes it for really good.
Zero G. Sure. Yeah, works.
Yeah.
Singing a civilian. You cannot do it with anyone who's impetuous or extremely impetuous. You cannot do it with anybody that has frenzy that has caused a wound and has become
impetuous.
G-synchronized models cannot do it. That is the aux bot, but not the auxilia, right?
Yeah,
it's the model that has G-sync on the profile. G-servants cannot do it. Nurseworm can't.
Nurseworm is a doctor worm.
remotes cannot do it. Right? Which covers a lot of the G-syncs and G-servants. So, you cannot be in a coordinated order. Since everybody's first thought, I'm going to sync all these civilians. I'm going to coordinated move back across the field. Nope. Cannot be part of a coordinated order, nor can you be part of a fire team in order to civivac sync a civilian. Got to pass a willpower to do it. And like I said before, specialists can sink two at once.
Mm-hmm.
You can bring those civilians back and then hand them off to somebody else. The way you hand it off to somebody else, that somebody else has to come up into base contact, friendly model, mm-hmm. and pass their own willpower check to sync with the civilian. And now that model's going to move, the civilian's going to move with that model instead of you. Now, also interesting to note, or important to note, that you have to be in base contact to roll the willpower to do the sync.
Mm-hmm.
But after that, it's just coherency. So zone of control. You don't have to remain in base contact.
It's like 8 inches.
They don't tag along like a supply box.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
So you can move in totally different directions, leave the civilian out in the middle of nowhere while mm-hmm. you're hugging cover, whatever. They do not have to be touching. They just have to be within coherency. You want all the multi-terrain and any terrain movement skills. You want fast models. They got to get all the way out there to do it.
Mm-hmm.
You can spam infiltrators. And instead of putting them in your close four zone, try to pass as mm-hmm. many rolls as possible to deploy in your enemy's dead zone so you're right near the civilians that they have to sync with.
That's not a bad plan.
Many of those infiltrators have multi-terrain on their profile already.
Yeah.
A lot of them. So, yep. Templates won't go off with a civilian nearby, right?
No.
So you can use the civvy to shield yourself from templates or mm-hmm. explode or things like that. Force them to use hit mode if they have a hit mode.
Mm-hmm.
All that kind of stuff.
I like that.
Yeah, so rescue. Biggest change is data tracker. You want to have... got to have one with your data tracker.
So, well, that was going to be my question for you. So what do you think of this, Tom? Do you hide your data tracker in your deployment zone and try to come by and pass it off? Or do you use a model that can run around a lot, like Achilles, that's 6'4 multi-terrain ODD as your data tracker? Or do you want him out just grabbing him and running back and handing him off to other people? Like, say, I'm going to use him to carry out this flank, and then another model, like, or like a Sphinx,
mm-hmm.
you know, and carry out one whole, like, they're going to get these two, and then I'm going to have somebody come up and get these other two. But making, like, originally I was like, oh man, if I was playing Steel Phalanx, a model like Achilles or a model like a Sphinx and Combined Army, be my data tracker, go up, grab one, and then I can have it back in deployment zone. But it's like, oh man, but then they're out there firing. You can only mm-hmm. get one. So you're depending on the other guys that go out there, run up and get them.
Again, this is not a decision that you have to make when you build your army list.
No,
this is a decision that can be that is made at the end of both players' deployments when it's all mm-hmm. done, and you can use that information that you have to make a wiser decision. Like, your plan may be, I'm going to use Achilles.
Mm-hmm.
He's going to run out there. He's going to grab stuff. I'm going to bring it all the way back, and I'm going to wait. You know, I'm going to spend turn one killing things with Achilles. And turn two, I'm going to go grab the thing with Achilles. And turn three, I'm going to move it back to my deployment zone with Achilles.
Mm-hmm.
Or whatever your plan is. But then you get there and you're like, wow, he has 74 Nisei machine guns.
My ODD doesn't mean anything.
So they're ignoring your ODD and all that nonsense. All that jazz. And they have mimetism coming back at you.
Mm-hmm.
And you may, you know... You may find that, Thurakitas that you have back in your deployment zone, or that Myrmidon backing up Phoenix's missile launcher is just part of the Enematarchus.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe, you know, you use Achilles to go grab it, and you bring it back, and then you break that Myrmidon out so he can sync with it.
Mm-hmm.
And that Myrmidon is your data tracker. You know, it... To be flexible with your choice of data tracker until you see the actual situation, how deployment goes and how the table looks like mm-hmm. and where those dudes are. Because you're right, you don't want to take your Sphinx out of the fight, who is 6'6",
mm-hmm.
multi-terrain, TO.
Flamethrower, Spitfire.
That dude can run all the way across, mm-hmm. grab a civilian, run it back, data tracking, pick it up. Then he can go do that on turn two with another civilian
mm-hmm.
and bring it back, let somebody else sync with it. Mm-hmm. Then he can run out and get, I mean, 12 inches per order of movement.
Yeah.
And if you can end him out of line of fire, spend an order, read camo,
mm-hmm.
marker state all the way out there, deal with that.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to say. Like, those are, if you have access to models like that, I really like those missions mm-hmm. like this. Because
all
like,
those
half the points are as long as you have more in your deployment zone than they do in theirs, and it's your data tracker. Like mm-hmm. it's half the points.
So remotes would be so good, except they can't sync.
Yeah.
So they are not so good.
No.
But like your first thought is, oh my gosh, they have 6-4 movement and forward observer and
I can grab two.
Multi-terrain. Oh no. Mm. He's a remote. Or you think your Ermendino has all, you know, the extra impetuous yeah. orders, gets all the way across. He's a specialist. You can go grab two of them. No, he's impetuous. He can't do it, Tony.
That's funny.
But yeah, it's again, it's a model that requires 5 HVTs,
mm-hmm.
4 to use as civilians, and then 1 to use as HVT. And it is a quote-unquote hard mission. Like, it's hard to wrap your brain around more so than, oh, I've got to go kill more army points? I could do that,
mm.
right? And it definitely tweaks your list construction,
mm-hmm.
right? Okay, here's my list that I've been playing and tweaking. Can it accomplish this mission? What do I need? How do I need to design it differently to be able to handle rescue? So it's definitely a more challenging one, which mm-hmm. does not make it bad.
No, it's fun.
It makes it different and definitely more challenging. And so people play it the first time, and they're like, yep, played rescue, tied 1-1, got her classified. And you hear that a lot.
Yeah, it's true.
So I think the challenge, like, the next challenge is like, yeah, I want to get at least 7 points on this.
Mm-hmm.
And keep practicing it until you do that instead of just sort of giving up on the mission and be like, yeah, I'll kill him, make sure he can't do it, I get my classified, call it a day.
You don't really get far, though, because like, you're getting at the most, well, like a tie or like a minor victory with 1 objective point.
Yeah.
That's almost like taking a loss.
Yep.
Especially in a larger tournament.
And I guess I'm not talking about tournaments so much, just like if we do it on game night.
Oh, yeah.
Nah, screw it, I'm just going to kill him. I don't want to think that hard.
How many 8 points on this? Get them all back to the dead zone and deployment zone. And with your data tracker in the deployment zone, it's 8 points. That's what I want to do. Maybe not even worry about the classified if you don't have to.
I think when I played, if I remember back to my Rumble, I think when I played Tony,
mm-hmm.
I had 4 infiltrating dudes and they all failed, including Ushia.
Oh, and she's bonus
superior.
Yeah, she's like a 16 or a 17 to hit.
Nope.
Yeah, I think if I was playing something like US, definitely be like, try to land all foxtrots and take like 2 or 3 of the infiltrating grunts to try to land those 2 as well, because mm-hmm. I believe they have jungle terrain.
Oh, I think when I played Stilgar, I think it was rescue, and he must have rolled 8 times
mm-hmm.
to land people near the civilians between his infiltrating grunts and his foxtrots and hard cases and whatever else.
Yeah, the grunts don't have jungle terrain. I was thinking of marauders.
Yeah, he must have rolled 8 or 10 times. He brought all, he totally spammed the infiltrators.
Yeah.
So I'm going to get as many near those HVT or the civilians as I can, man. So good luck with the rescue. The choice of data tracker going to largely depend on the situation after deployment. And, but yeah, have a big hefty guy that can go do it on his own.
Mm-hmm.
And then he comes back and he's out of the game, or have a well-protected data tracker in the back in your deployment zone.
That's what I like.
Where your messenger, be it Achilles or Sphinx, can go run errands and bring them back to the guy.
I like the running the errands.
All right, so that will bring us to acquisition. One thing you want to remind your tournament players about as they start a round of acquisition is that it has 16-inch deployment zones, which is abnormal. And all of the scoring is at the end of the game. There are two antennas, and there is a tech coffin in the center.
Mm-hmm.
And for each activated antenna, you get a point, so you can get up to two, because there's two antennas.
Mm-hmm.
And you can flip them A, B. It's a willpower roll with a specialist if you're an engineer or a hacker. It's whip plus three. Then for each controlled antenna, you get a point at the end of the game. So that's worth two more. We're up to four.
Okay.
Any model can control an antenna. It doesn't have to be a specialist. The only stipulation is there can be no enemy models also touching the antenna. Control the tech coffin. Same deal. Doesn't have to be a specialist. Can be anybody. That's the one in the center. That is three giant objective points. And if you're controlling it with your data tracker, it's worth plus two. So a whopping five. Half.
Yeah, it's half.
To control the tech coffin at the end of the game with your data tracker. Then you have one classified worth 1 point. It will go three rounds, or if somebody's in retreat, it will stop at the end of their turn. And that's all there is to it, Kip. So there's no fancy synchronizing civilians or anything. It's just very straightforward. Two antennas, activate them, control them, and control the center thing with your data tracker. So, big boss beefy boy.
Yeah.
For that data tracker.
I do agree with you. Unless I have really, like, I'm like having PTSD right now while we're reading this, because this was probably the worst game of Infinity I ever played. One of the first time I played this mission.
Where was the first time you played this mission?
Armageddon against Ka-chow.
You probably should practice.
I was going to play it, but it's like, oh, we'll do this.
His Cantonese is also much better than yours.
Yeah.
And Nathan's.
I could not make any rolls. I had that plan to run up with a big beefy guy. He just never got to get there. He used an Umbra and forward deployed. And since it's 16 inches, he forward deployed up to 20.
Mm-hmm.
So he is right against the building that it's on the other side of, and just used things to clear out the way. And at the end went bloop, bloop, and touched it, because you can cyber mask.
Was he going second?
He went second. No, he went first.
Huh.
He just killed everything.
Because if you go first,
mm-hmm.
Let's see if this is what he did. Because here's what I would do if I went first.
Okay.
I would try to remove enemy specialists so that they can't activate the antennas. Because there shouldn't be a ton of specialists in this mission. So maybe you can assassinate the 1, 2, 3 that they have. I would try to assassinate whoever they have nominated as their data tracker, since that's open information.
Mm-hmm.
I would set up covering fire. Notice I have not said I would push the buttons on the antennas or move up and control them. No. I would set up covering fire, like people in suppression in the midfield, or drop a bunch of mines and suppression right in that midfield line near the stuff to make it really hard for them to approach those areas that they need to get to. And I would spend those first one or two turns just killing as much as I can without exposing anything like my data tracker that I need later.
So let me tell you how effective that was, because that's almost exactly what happened. He used a total reaction HMG, so a Q drone, marksmaned it, and then proceeded to go one-on-one with my grunt HMG, because I had the full team just surrounding that center. Then went one-on-one with my sniper, and then one-on-one with this guy, and just used the HMG to just mow down a lane. and then moved to Shrouded and Planted Mines.
Okay.
By the antennas. And then didn't have enough to recamo, but he just went prone and ran around the backside. And then was going to move the Umbra, but it's like, no, I'll just leave him there. So yeah, that's exactly what he did. He spent the majority of his orders on his Q-Drone HMG. And just murdered things. Luckily, I got smoked down so he didn't kill my Devil Dog, because that was like the only thing I got to kill anything with turn two. It was a chain rifle. I was like, I'm not making any rolls. I'm going to start using template weapons. But yeah, it was really sound tactics, because then I had, not only was I down, I think, five orders like after that round of shooting, and my heavy guns that are covering this thing, but he also had mined the center. So it's like, oh man, if I move any of my camo tokens, it's going to blow up my other camo token. And he basically just locked me into a funnel. So I couldn't, I had a couple of, foxtrots on either flank that I could work. So I tried to like bring Van Zant in. I was like, I know he's got a freaking knocked for missile launcher on top of this building over there, 'cause there's a baby worm sitting there with nothing on top of that building.
So that makes like, it a little obvious.
Yeah, I was like, I know there's a, and it's what it was. So I brought him in, and
they've got automatic kit. Why is it anyway?
Yeah, I don't know, but it was just like, tried to do that, couldn't hit the Umbra, and it was just all him all day. So that is actually a very good sound tactic, because I was down so many orders after the first two turns that I couldn't even make a last ditch effort with my data tracker, because I just didn't have the orders to do so. So it was a perfect taking out everything, strategically taking out my big stuff, and then just making it to where I had to funnel in one area, and then he just pincer moved me with his Unidron fire team, just went in and did a final sweep.
Oh, was he playing Onyx?
Yeah, he's playing Onyx Force, so it was really nice. Good game, man. Like, really sound tactic. So I would have to agree with your assessment on how you would take first turn, because I watched it from the other end of the table and it worked. When you can't make a face-to-face roll or armor rolls.
So you had a Devil Dog?
I did have a Devil Dog.
So it's got an antipode that has sensor?
Yeah.
So you could have, you know, revealed those mines.
I tried. I got killed.
Well, you don't do it in line of fire of the mine.
No, I got killed before I get to those mines.
No.
Like I said, it was a rough day for
you. I have hit a lot of U.S. Ariadne grunts with a heavy machine gun, specifically from the Q drone, for example, and they've never failed that many armor saves that it was able to spend a majority of orders and take. He always does.
It was not a good day.
I'm like slicing the pie, take him on one-on-one. Sounds like a good idea. Nope. Oh, and the sniper got him. Oh.
Yeah, it would be like he'd get four hits, even though I had two dice coming back. It was a bad day. It was a bad day, but no, it's sound tactic. And he had backup too. He had the plasma sniper. That was what started killing me too. Was when I started taking on the Unidrons, that plasma just smoked me.
Well, okay, so overall strategies, no matter what faction you're playing, so you know whether you've got first or second turn before you are declaring your data tracker, and a lot of the conversation I see is like, oh, well, what makes a good data tracker in Onyx? Or what makes a good data tracker in Ariadne? Like, I think that's the wrong question to ask.
Yeah, it is.
It's like, now that I see where he's deployed, what can I use as my data tracker to accomplish what will get me points? So in this mission, if I'm going first, I know that I have to be on that center console and survive at least one turn of shooting, right? If I save him until round three, and he gets to the center console, and he can't be in a marker state, he can't be hidden deployed, right? Gets to the center console, he's got to survive an entire round from my enemy. So yeah, I want to spend the first one or two turns killing the enemy so that the main threats aren't there. But if I'm going first, now my data tracker, I want him to be something that can survive, something that has TO camo and multiple wounds, or ODD and multiple wounds.
Yeah, right? So you get the negative six, not the marker six.
Something that can be in suppression fire. So if you, and I hope, hopefully you're all using terrain as objectives instead of little markers, because standing out in the middle of nowhere with no cover is foolish.
Yeah, and usually when you use markers.
It's a much better game using actual terrain as your objectives, for sure. What were you going
to say? I would say even if you're using markers, just like what's the norm that I've seen is they count as silhouette fives. The problem with that is somebody like me, I get, and that's my, it's my own fault. It's not anybody else's. When there's not actual terrain on the table, I forget that they block line of fire, which has screwed me.
Well, that's probably why probably the rule says if you're using markers, they don't.
Yeah,
they're markers and they don't count as anything. Mm-hmm. And if I mean,
if you use terrain pieces, they count as terrain and don't be removed from the table. Yeah,
and if you're in that silhouette five camp, at least cut up a bunch of PVC pipe.
There you go.
Prime it black.
That's cheap.
Yeah.
Such a good idea. Have we ever said that?
You can put it on your 40mm base or your 40mm marker cutout that you already have.
Mm-hmm.
You can use the pre-printed ones from Use on Minis. You can,
those are good. Is that the ones you...
All the way up to, you know, if you want to be super high class, you can use the beautiful antennas from Warsenal, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, I mean, there's...
PVC
pipe. The hard part is saying, well, yes, it's a marker, but we count them as silhouette five. That's easy to be forgotten, like you just said.
I do.
So if you have an actual piece of terrain, and maybe it's shaped funky or whatever, you sit, you know, and use silhouette five just like you would a model, that's fine. For those Muson Minis ones, they're a 40mm base, which is the size they're supposed to be, and then there's terrain on it. So we count as a cylinder, but only up to the height of the actual terrain piece. So a silhouette two, I believe, can actually see over those.
I think so.
So anyway... That was a tangent. Talking about data trackers. So if I have to take the first turn, I know I'm going to need something that is going to have some survivability. Something that can, well, can't cyber mask, can it?
Nope, can't ever be a marker. As I said, with your TO, you get the negative six. You just can't ever camo.
Yeah. So. High armor, multiple wounds, some TO or ODD or whatever, something strong, something that can go into suppression so you can add another negative three, and then watch its back so they can't get behind it either. Something that can go prone, so if you're using terrain as objectives, it can hide behind the thing, so you do have to get all the way around. But if I'm going second... Right? All I have to do is be the last one to touch it. So now I can have something maybe not so strong. Maybe not, like, instead of my strong models out going killing things and ramboing, because if I lose it, I still have my data tracker in my pocket. But it's, you know, something sort of hidden that can be quick and get there fast. Like the Umbra hiding behind a thing until the very final turn.
Yeah, we both went that route. It's just if you're going second, just make sure you have enough orders to get there, especially if it's mined out and a lot of people that are covering it.
Yeah, but like, so Sphinx is good.
Oh, yeah.
But it can't go prone, so it's always going to be seen. But a Sphinx, you know, TO camo, negative six in suppression fire, negative nine in cover is negative 12. That's good.
Yeah, it's really good.
But Anathematic... Who can do all of those same things but be prone and hiding behind it, the objective.
Yeah, because then you have to get close.
Could be better.
Most scenarios.
Well, yeah, it depends on the terrain. But, yeah. A Swiss Guard, a Hack Tau, right? All of those guys. And if they're also specialists, on their way to that central thing, they can flip the antenna.
Mm-hmm.
Let somebody else control it. And then I guess support your central position, right?
Mm-hmm.
Have a dude like Data Razi is a good thing to have around on turn three if you had to go first. And now he's standing there, and if you move up to threaten my thing in the center, it can suppress or it can dodge or it can do whatever. Meanwhile, the Data Razi can throw smoke.
So it can't get shot at?
So it stops all that shooting, right?
Mm-hmm. And I would probably do that in a situation where to come out, you'll come out of smoke to touch the button so that you can still suppress them.
Yeah.
Yeah. Don't just be like, I'm going to throw smoke right on top of us so nobody can ever see. No.
Well, yeah, if you're, if, yeah. If you're a heavy infantry, if you use a heavy infantry or a tag, you got to support it with like a hacker in the area, right?
Yeah.
So that they, you know, well, my plan is I'm going to go up and I'm going to possess the tag. Oh, but wait a minute, there's that killer hacker right there, and I can't get to the tag without getting within the killer hacker's hacking area. So I could take it on, but that's never safe.
If they pass their reset and then you just let that killer hacker go through, then...
Or you do that, and you get killed by the killer hacker and don't possess the tag.
Yeah.
Now you got to deal with the killer hacker first. Yeah. So,
yeah.
Support it with hacking, support it with smoke. You can throw fairy dust on it, like the heavy infantry. Throw fairy dust on it the turn before, at least, you know, give it some hacking protection. Although, there's not much they can do to heavy infantry.
Yeah,
they can immobilize it, they can isolate it, but they can't stop me from scoring unless they kill me.
Yep.
But if they immobilize me, it makes me way easier to be taken out, because now I'm no longer in suppression fire.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just like...
You're sitting there. Yeah, you're just sitting there. In the trenches taking grenades.
Yeah, so... if you go second... If you choose to go second, it means you get that end game, right?
Mm-hmm.
Kill the things off the objectives and take them for yourself the last minute. Be super powerful. If you go first, you get the opportunity to remove enemy specialists, assassinate their data tracker, set up that covering fire, mine and suppress up that midfield, make it hard for them to approach at all.
I think that's actually a little bit stronger in a mission where... You're not taking a lot of specialists.
Yeah, and you're not killing the data tracker, or you're not killing the designated target or whatever, so you don't have to... The deployment's not any more important than it normally is for counter-deploy. So, again, it's going to depend on your army. I think averages being average...
Mm-hmm.
Probably still take deployment so I can see where everything's at and counter deploy it, and then put the onus on them to decide, are they going to take the first turn and be super aggressive, or and thereby giving me the hammer like in Bags or right, all those games where you have to go last, cancel out their points with you,
yes,
right? Does, you know,
knock
give,
them off,
give me the hammer by going second?
Yeah.
Or do they decide they want to go second to have the hammer, and now that gives me the advantage of giving me that first turn to assassinate a bunch of stuff or plug up the middle, make things really uncomfortable. So I think, again, I'm probably picking deployment, and I'm happy with...
With whatever you get? With
either one, if they want to go first or second.
Mm-hmm.
Again, everything being average. If I take a super aggressive alpha strike type of list, well, then yeah, I'm going to go first, of course, but... Speaking in generalities.
That's all I got. I actually chose deployment on this last one, so I kind of think that most of the time I kind of want to go first now.
Well, you can't...
Well, it depends on the table as well.
You can't base your entire tactic off of, well, I did this once and I lost the game.
It's true.
He never failed a roll with his Q drone, so therefore going first is bad. Like, no, what?
It's not. Yeah. I'm just being a little jokester.
Wiener. Oh, wiener. Jokester.
Yeah, sorry. Jokester about the fact that it was just, like, not a good day. But, yeah, that's all I got to say.
All right, so hunting party.
This one's fun.
Hunting party.
I've only played this once. I played against our good old friend Dan Barnaby out of New Mexico.
Oh, was this down at the tournament you went to Albuquerque for? When it was brand new?
Yeah.
Nobody knew how it was supposed to work?
Yeah, it was fun.
Before any of the questions were answered?
Oh, man.
So there's a lot to unpack here.
Yeah.
First of all, there is no loss of lieutenant in this mission, and the identity of your lieutenant is always public information, even if in a marker state. They cannot be in hidden deployment. They cannot be airborne deployed. They have to be on the table at the start of the game. And it is public information. If you are in a hollow echo state. You have to point out which one of the hollow echoes is the lieutenant. So there's no, like, stop, like, don't game it. It's just known. It is known. And there's no way around it being known. If there is no lieutenant during the tactical phase of your turn, because it wasn't deployed, or it's in a null state, or it's isolated, or if it's immobilized, one or two,
okay,
then you have to publicly name a new one. And it must be a model or marker on the table again. You can't nominate an invisible thing up in the sky or a hidden deployment thing. You have to publicly nominate a model or marker. Has to be on the table.
Kind of like decap, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's going to end after turn three, or if somebody starts their turn and retreat, it'll end at the end of their turn. You have 12-inch deployment zones as normal. It introduces a new thing called hunt down.
Yeah.
If a model is isolated or immobilized, one or two, at the end of the game, it is considered hunted down.
Mm-hmm.
Any specialists or lieutenants not deployed by the end of the game are also considered hunted down. All troopers with any kind of pistol also get a stun pistol for free.
That's dirty.
And all veteran, elite, or HQ troops. Now, to be clear, in Army, on the top right of every troop's profile, it tells you what the troop classification is. So this is not a skill. This is not down in the profile. This is up at the top right. You usually never looked at it before. You know, it's right across from the ISC, right? They have a troop type, and there's elites, and there's veterans, and there's headquarters troops, and there's line troops, and there's characters, and there's support troops, and there's all these different ones, right? And they never really mattered for anything. They matter for this now. If the troop classification is veteran, again, not the veteran skill.
No.
Not veteran level one, veteran level two. Nope. Not Morat, right? That includes veteran. Just the veteran classification, which is different than the veteran skill. If it includes veteran, elite, or headquarters, they also get an adhesive launcher, which in some cases is hilarious.
Yeah.
And if they have a pistol, they also get the stun pistol, which, because of burst, sometimes the better option, sometimes being within eight. multi-weapons, you know, they have that, they had that weird rule where they have the stun mode, but you can use it if both players agree. But, you know, in this mission, you're allowed to use your stun mode. The problem is it's always burst one, which is not super attractive. In this mission, instead of stun...
This is huge. Yeah, that's huge.
Stun ammo, instead of causing the stunned state, stun ammo causes a mobilized one. Now, a couple of things here. My first thing was like, oh, wait. Flash pulses now cause stunned. And so I was super excited. And I was like, so that's going to be burst two and long range. No. Flash pulses still use flash ammo that inflict the stun state, but they are not stun ammo. So it's not going to apply to flash pulse. Flash pulse still does their stunned thing, which isn't going to help you hunt people down. But stun ammo, instead of the stun state, is going to cause immobilized one. Stun ammo requires two BTS rolls. Two BTS rolls. And you also autofail your guts, unless you have courage. But yeah, so not a lot of stun usage out there. But important, yeah, two BTS rolls on stun ammo. So that stun pistol, you're going to get within 8 inches... and double tap them.
Yeah, as I said, that those are
burst two
brutal.
So, at the end of the game, you got to look at your specialists and your lieutenants. And if they were a lieutenant at the time they were made isolated or immobilized, then they count as hunted down. And yeah, so if you there's antennas, by the way,
they're kind of an afterthought.
There's two antennas. There's one on the left. There's one on the right. They're on the center line of the table.
Mm.
And if you connect them, it's a specialist doing a whip roll, and you can flip them between player A and player B. You get one for each one, which is 2 points total, right?
Mm-hmm.
One for each. If you hunt down, which we just went over, more specialists, it's 2 points.
Mm-hmm.
If you hunt down more lieutenants, that's worth 4 points. And if you each hunt down the same number of lieutenants, it's worth 3, as long as you each do one.
Mm-hmm.
If you both don't do it at all, you don't get those points.
I know.
And then you have two classified worth 1 point each. So you do want to be a little conscious of your specialist population, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because you want to bring enough to do the classifieds, but you don't want to present so many targets of opportunity that it's easy for them to hunt down more specialists than they can hunt down of yours. So like 2 might be ideal.
Yeah. Like, yeah, between 2 and 4.
No, I ain't taking 4. No way. Stun ammo is causing immobilized one.
Mm-hmm.
The adhesive launcher causes immobilized on a physique minus 6 check, which is ugly, right?
Yeah, and that's the best because then they're immobilized for the rest of the game unless an engineer helps them out.
So immobilized one and immobilized two, they have the exact same effects in that you can make no short movement skill other than discover.
Mm-hmm.
You can make no attacks or short skills except for reset, regeneration, sensor, or auto med kit. Mm-hmm. So I love the idea that you're immobilized, but you can still like regenerate or auto medicate yourself. Like you bite down on the fake
the capsule.
Tooth.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you can reset, you can discover, you can sensor, but you're not going anywhere, you're not doing anything, you're not making any attacks. And that's the effect.
Mm-hmm.
The difference between immobilized one and immobilized two is that in immobilized one, you can escape via successful reset.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say I shoot you with the stun ammo in this mission and you fail and you're immobilized one.
Mm-hmm.
And then a hacker comes by because you're heavy infantry.
Mm-hmm.
And he decides he's going to immobilize you with a hacking program and you reset and you win the role. Not only do you beat the hacking roll, but you also cancel your immobilized one state from my stun pistol earlier. Because you passed a reset, you're out of the state. Also, an engineer can walk up to you base-to-base, whip roll, fix it, no longer immobilized. The difference with immobilized two is that the only way it can be fixed is if the engineer walks up to you, whip roll, or his helper bot, and fixes the state. There is no resetting out of immobilized two.
Yeah, it's not fun.
So, yeah. Balance, man. Clever balance. You want to have enough specialists to get the classifieds, to get the antennas, because you need a specialist to flip those antennas. But you don't want to offer too many to be hunted down by the enemy, right?
Yeah, I agree. I like to play the denial role on this one. I think that's what the last time I played, I only had three specialists. What you were saying earlier about the little sticker in the top corner, you can also filter it on Army by classification, and it'll bring up veteran, elite. Look at those, because the adhesive launchers are huge. Like, because that's when you have glued people all over and you don't have to worry about them getting line of fire and being like, well, I'm going to reset. They're like, I have to have an engineer. So like the adhesive launchers are like where it's at, honestly.
If you can keep engineer and helper bot alive at the end of the game, turn 3 could just be a whole lot of
breaking.
You're like, if you're going second, your enemy uncure.
I was gonna say, what is the super glue that the spray that that gets rid of your super glue bond? Go around spraying them with uncure.
So you know, your enemy, he's like, okay, I've gotten these six guys isolated, right? Mm-hmm. And three of my guys are, but I, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And then you spend that last turn and you don't even engage with the enemy. You just send that helper bot around like you're like, fix that immobilized. Okay, now you've...
That's so good.
And then you get rid of all the work that they did. So I think...
Jeez, I want an engineer in the middle and then a... Or in the far corner and then a helper bot on in the middle and then one on the other flank.
You want to hide and protect that engineer mm-hmm. because the enemy is going to come and try to immobilize it.
Oh, that's such a good move.
So...
I need to not play Ariadna so much so you can think of things like that.
So,
helper bots, what are those?
Fire teams, especially multiple fire teams like Triads and Enematarchos.
Okay.
Their stun weapons mm-hmm. are going to be burst two now that are usually burst one. Mm-hmm. But those stun pistols that everybody who has a pistol gets one for free, that's going to be burst three all of a sudden.
Oof.
So, yes, you've got to get within 8 inches. But, mm-hmm. I mean, think about Steel Phalanx and Enematarchos who have smoke cover, right? And all of a sudden, boom, we're within 8 inches. You've got ODD to shoot me back, and I've got burst three on my stun pistol.
Mm-hmm.
You're hunted down. But there's dirtier things than that, Kip. And it's QK.
Okay.
I was looking through, and I've probably missed some, and people will tell us. People do love to point out our mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
And we love it when they do it.
Agreed.
I was going through, and I was looking for linkable troops
mm-hmm.
that were also either veteran
mm-hmm.
or elite
okay.
or HQ. And not only that, I was looking for ones that came equipped with an adhesive launcher already.
Oh, so that you can get doubles?
Kaplans, Kip.
Yeah.
Kaplans are veteran troopers.
Mm-hmm.
They there's a profile with an ADHL.
Mm-hmm.
Because they are veteran, they will get an ADHL. So
they
that
get double.
So that's going to be a burst 2 ADHL. But because they're in a link,
mm-hmm.
that will be a burst 3 adhesive launcher, which is plus 3 from 8 to 16.
Ugh.
And if it's a 5-man link... they're going to be plus 3 ballistic skill.
Yeah.
To use their burst 3 adhesive launcher, and you just sit there and be glued, and you're hunted down, and you're hunted down, and you're hunted. It's like Oprah. You're hunted down, and you're hunted down, and you're hunted down.
Oh, you know what the best part about that is, though?
That mimetism?
And that profile also can be an engineer.
Right.
it's 4 more points, but I was like, wait a minute, because I just popped it up. Yeah, you can have
No, Bob was doing all that gluing, but he got crit, and now he's glued.
You can literally...
I'm going to go fix him.
You can literally run 4 of those engineers and then 1 Spitfire, as you're like, well, I'm need some...
Oh, you're not a specialist.
Support.
I'll just kill you.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Gowrail.
Okay.
Toha. So you can mm-hmm. have several of them in links because they can have yeah. unlimited links. They're elites.
Nice.
So they get adhesive launcher, and wouldn't you know it? Because everybody takes the sniper all the time or the Spitfire.
Mm-hmm.
There's an adhesive launcher Gowrail with his MSV2 that you can pop in a triad and now get another ADHL because he's elite and get the plus one. So another burst 3 ADHL, but this time. With MSV2.
Oh, man.
Moving up the field with a McCall throwing smoke. And, hey, why not a Kumotil bioengineer? In case any of your guys get glued, you can pop them right back out. Yeah.
That's pretty brutal.
So with stun ammo...
I didn't even think about that with that burst 3.
With stun ammo being 2 BTS rolls...
Mm-hmm.
I think you want a high BTS lieutenant to start the game with.
That's a good point.
And even better is a high BTS lieutenant that has ODD or TO camo.
Mm-hmm. So they're hard to hit.
Hard to hit yeah. and hard to get through the armor, the BTS. So, and that BTS is great because the other way to isolate or immobilize folks, especially, mm-hmm. you know, if they're heavy infantry or remotes mm-hmm. or whatever, is hacking. BTS is good against that too, I hear.
Yeah.
So
a little bit.
BTS 9 lieutenants, Kip. These are the ones I found. Avatar. He doesn't suck.
No, not at all. And that and the new model is absolutely beautiful.
And the new Halloween missions that they put out today, because we're recording on a Wednesday, which is back in the day, mm-hmm. by the time you listen to this, on Friday. New Halloween missions came out today, and they're adorable, and everybody gets an avatar for free, so that's fun.
What?
Yeah. Everybody gets a free avatar. Not the mod. Like, you can't, like, send a coupon into Corvus yeah. and they send you a free avatar model.
No, but in the missions.
So basically, everybody's playing a 437-point list.
Wow, I guess, okay.
Because everybody gets...
Wait, like all factions?
Yeah. every army list gets a free avatar. No Sepster, though.
Okay.
Because everybody's undead, so...
Oh, okay.
Can't Sepsterize them. Anyway, so Avatar's BTS-9. Here, he doesn't suck.
Okay.
He's immune to possession, and... yeah. Also, he's a headquarters troop, so he gets an adhesive launcher.
All right.
Just wreck everyone with the Avatar in this mission, and your Imatrons and Ikadrons will be just fine in the backfield.
Man.
He gets an adhesive launcher.
That's...
And he's got ODD.
Freaking ridiculous.
Also in combined, the other BTS-9 lieutenant option that gives you an extra order besides the Avatar, mm-hmm. Cornet Gazarot, Superior Warrant Officer.
That's nice.
But he's a character, though, so no free ADHL.
I literally like the Avatar, because then you're like, well, you also got Strategos level 3 mm-hmm. as well.
Screw your reserves, I get an extra order.
Oh, man.
Interventors, BTS-9, mm-hmm. usually hidden real deep far back, hard to get to.
Mm-hmm.
I got to Pano, and that was fun, because Jotam... is BTS-9. It could be your lieutenant.
And he's a HQ unit?
I think Jotams are mechanized units.
Okay.
I don't know. I would have to look that up.
But it's just it's armor. It's just a hard to hit.
It was armor 10, BTS-9.
Yeah.
And it's just funny to have that big, dumb dude as your lieutenant. Mm-hmm. Also, Father Knight's BTS-9.
That's a nice one. That's one really easy to hide too.
Can be prone, super easy.
Mm-hmm.
Aleph gets Maroots. That's not a terrible lieutenant.
No.
Nima for Toha. Nima Sitar is BTS-9.
Goodness gracious.
And in Haq Islam, Asawira. It's funny because going through Haq Islam, I'm like, they're not going to have any BTS. Oh, that's right. Asawira. You know who doesn't have BTS-9, Lieutenant?
Anything Ariadna.
There it is.
I was just sitting here, I was like, no.
No biotechnological shield for
anything.
Them.
Anything. Yeah, they're rough in this one. Although they could have some really awesome ADHL units, because they don't have very many. I don't think there's one elite troop in there. Yeah, there's no elite troops. So you only have HQ, which is a blackjack. So they can get an ADHL, or a veteran, which is either the 5th Minutemen Ohio
mm-hmm.
or the Marauders. The Marauders can Haris. Ohio can core fire team, so you can
have
two.
Have 8 linked adhesive launchers, because everybody gets one.
Yep, and then the Minutemen will be on like BTS-16 base, as long as they stay a 5-man. And they have all the flamethrowers.
You mean BS?
I mean BS.
Because I'm pretty sure their BTS is not 16.
No, BS, yeah.
Not only is it multiples of 3 for BTS, and 16 is not, it's also Ariadna.
Yeah, I meant Blitz of Skill, but yeah, like there's a... That's what I would run in this mission if I was sticking with my US, because that's a whole lot of ADHL running around the table. Crappy thing is... Only engineer option, dozer, no bots, availability 1.
Oh, yeah, well.
So, it's kill or be killed, eat or be eaten with that.
Yeah, so Avatar's got Dr. Worm and the
oh, yeah.
The Kurgat. right?
Mm-hmm.
Cornac is interesting because still the BTS-9, but also can't be isolated because he's a Morat.
That's a good thing right there. Oh, man.
And he's also gets the Kurgat's Hukin Haris, right?
Mm-hmm.
So there's, you know, an engineer Haris team that can go chip people out of glue and stuff. But yet, playing against Morats, or with Morats, depending on how you want to look at it, they ignore isolated. So the only way to hunt them down
mm-hmm.
is immobilizing them with mm-hmm. stun or other effects. What's wrong, Kip? You look distraught.
No, I was just saying it's isolated. So you know my new favorite little tactic from last week with playing combined and you have bit. He mm-hmm. does all the pitchers, and then if you have an E-drone on the table, it can exile. So don't be running up on that avatar if there's a bunch of repeaters everywhere with specialists on your fire team, because you can exile that Ford Observer that's in that triad or a fire team or an Endomotargos, and then they're isolated, and that's a specialist.
Mm-hmm.
So good. So that's why I was like, oh my gosh, I didn't even think about that.
So total non sequitur of what we're actually talking about.
Yeah, my bad, sorry. Just
right.
Squirrel.
No problem.
My bad.
Mm-hmm.
I just thought you said isolated and they can't. So, Morats cannot be isolated. And I was like, oh my gosh.
Morats cannot be isolated. So the only mm-hmm. way to do it is to immobilize. So, you know, Mutawiya are really good at isolating things because they have jammers, they don't need line of fire, and they get the free impetuous order, and they have that irregular order, and they're only 5 points, and
mm-hmm.
they have big templates, and they cannot lie. And so they're really good for this mission.
Mm-hmm.
But Morats don't have to worry about the jammer
mm.
because they cannot be isolated. Your Morat hackers don't have to worry about being isolated via hacking program. However, if you take the E-drone, that's not a Morat, even though it's in your Morat sectorial.
Mm.
Right?
That is.
So is it an advantage in this mission? Sure.
Yeah, especially going up.
But it's not enormous. It wouldn't make me go, oh my God, that is huge.
Yeah, I mean, because most of the time people are going to be ADHLing you anyway. That's a situational thing. Like Mutts, I did play this mission against Hawk, and there were 3 Mutts on the table. And that was like the first things that I made sure that I killed or had line of fire towards.
Well, and then they're winning anyway because you just spent work killing 5-point models.
Luckily, I went second, and I would just position things where if they use their impetuous, that they'd have to come out in the open. So got lucky on that. Didn't help me out because I almost lost anyway. But yeah. I'm like, Mutts are scary in this. So they can just run up and
mm-hmm.
throw smoke, and I can do it to whoever. I can isolate better than you.
So there is potential for a lot of weird interactions in this mission that I don't really want to talk about because they're rare.
And, okay.
It's like, you know, so you were immobilized, but then somebody shot you and killed you. At the end of the game, you're in a null state. Are you still in a mobilized state?
I see what you're saying.
Or does a null state render all previous states void? Or like, you know, I isolate you when you're the lieutenant, Kip.
Okay.
And now you have to pick a new lieutenant.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But now my engineer comes up and fixes your isolated state. So at the end of the game, You were a lieutenant, but you're not isolated now, so I don't count as isolating that lieutenant?
No, because he's not your lieutenant anymore. Well, I mean, he was your lieutenant when you isolated him.
Well, right. At the end of the game is when you score. And so that's what I mean.
I see what you're saying.
There's a lot of vagaries and like, wait, he was isolated, but now he's not isolated. But when he was isolated, he was the lieutenant.
Mm.
And now... And it's just a lot of keeping track, right? Mm-hmm. Like, so you're the lieutenant. I've isolated you.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that other guy becomes lieutenant. You come up, and now you unisolate yourself, right? Mm-hmm. Engineer comes up. You're no longer isolated. Yeah. I isolate you again. Now we're at the end of the game. You are isolated, and you were a lieutenant at some point. Like, and when I isolated you the first time, but then you fixed it, but then I isolated you again. So at the end of the game, were you a lieutenant that were isolated? No, because that one was fixed. But I isolated you again. And you weren't a lieutenant when I isolated you the second time. So there's a lot of questions about this, and hopefully the FAQ will come to the most concise and logical and easy to score version, which to me would be at the end of the game, if you're isolated or immobilized, and at any point in the game you were a lieutenant, then that counts.
Yeah.
Instead of having to keep track of the timeline.
Mm-hmm.
So I isolated you when you were a lieutenant, but then you fixed it. So now you're no longer the lieutenant because you got isolated, had to nominate a new one. But then you fixed your isolation. You don't automatically become a lieutenant again. But then you get isolated again. But by that isolation, you were not the lieutenant.
Oh, yeah, that's way too much, man.
That's why I hope when the FAQ for this comes out, it's the if at any time you're a lieutenant and at the end of the game you are in one of these states, then it counts and scores as hunted down instead of, well, at the time you were at...
That's really, yeah. You just did that to me. I was like, wait.
Yep. So for now,
Computing. Really fun
mission to play with the dudes on game night, especially your veteran dudes that have a real firm grasp of the rules. Not so much a candidate to use in an ITS tournament with a bunch of new players who are still getting used to their own rules and their own factions and the basics of the game, because Infinity is in depth.
Mm-hmm.
And it takes focus and study, which makes it sound like a job, but that's, I think, what a lot of people really like about it.
That's what I like about it.
It's not a... It can totally be a casual game.
I would agree, because...
If you don't... But then don't expect to be the best at it, right?
Like, I kind of get what you're saying.
You can't just walk into it once a month and be like, I'm going to play and I'm going to win all my games. Wait, I didn't win?
No.
Wait, what do you mean it works that way?
Okay.
Like,
yeah, no.
There's a lot of depth to it. So this mission, not great for the new crowd.
I was just going to say I agree with that. Because...
Except on like weekly game night.
Because
right now there's too many questions that could, if we rule it this way, I win the tournament. And if we rule it this way, you win the tournament. And that's not a good... But total fun debate to have on game night on Monday, where you can look at it from both sides with nothing at stake and nothing on the line, for sure.
No, agreed. One thing that, especially with new players, I really wish and hope that they add, since they're doing a lot of these classifications, that they add that to the printed out army lists. Because... If you're a new player and you don't know anything, and they're like, oh, yeah, this is my veteran troop. He has ADHLs. How are you even going to question that?
Yeah.
Like, you can't, you don't even know. And if you, like you were saying, you're just getting to know your army, you're just going to have to believe it. And what if somebody made a mistake or whatever? But I mean, those have to be printed out, man. Like, write it down for yourself so you remember. but. If more of these are going to be like that, like I would love that to print out on the actual army list.
There needs to be an update to army where it prints out on the army list. What I did, you know, I went through army and circled or wrote in elite or veteran on the ones that were. And you know what? A lot of those AD troops, a lot of the 82 troops. Or not 82, 84, I guess. AD combat jump.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of those guys are veteran or elite?
I think elite.
Either way.
Nope, veteran.
Right? So like your Ektromo, your Tiger Soldier, your... not Bagmari, the other word that I get. Achilles, Sikh Commandos.
Mm-hmm.
You're like all of those dudes are going to have ADHLs.
Yeah, I'm popping up right now.
So it's really easy to get them into that 8 to 16 inch range.
Yeah, most of them are elite, like Rajiks.
Is it elite?
Mm-hmm.
Better, yeah.
Boarding shotgun ADHLs. What?
So A lot of those guys are going to have ADHLs, and they are in the best position to get in and pop some fools.
Yeah, especially like just even walking in off the side.
All right, so that is going to wrap up for now until we get the official FAQ or whatever. That is going to wrap up Treason 9 season. Season 9, Treason of the ITS. And played in one event, just IO Incident. Ran two events, Arizona Armageddon and In Lieu of Lewis over at IO. And look forward to playing some more. Yeah.
Damn, you played in two already. No, you ran two. You
didn't get to play. Only played in one. Played in Iowa.
Nathan.
Yep, all Nathan's fault. Nathan decided he didn't want to come, even though he was signed up all week long. The morning of, he's like, yeah, I'm not going to go. And then I didn't get to play because of it. But my cousin came. You know what? You either would have known that ahead of time. It was just so heartbreaking. All right, so that's going to do it. Let us get out of here.
Conversation can serve no purpose anymore. Goodbye.
So since we've been talking about missions and all the new missions, I wanted to take a little moment of silence to say all of the missing missions that we will miss. And, you know, we had a good run, you know, but it was just time to move on. And so I just wanted to say a formal goodbye to the Armory.
Aww.
King of whoever gets in that room first usually wins. CZ Antennas. You were as good as your close cousin, but not as good, so we had to send you packing. Cold Sleep.
Yeah, good
It's riddance. Cold because nobody ever played it, so it never got warm. Nimbus Zone. Oh, how everybody hated Nimbus Zone. Would like to say
you're gonna make the hipsters. To. You're gonna make the hipsters mad. I liked it.
Hey, Antenna Field. Had a good run. You had a good run, Antenna Field. But no more. You were treason. You're treasonous. So we put you on the engineering deck and kicked you out.
Yeah, I missed that one.
Engineering deck was cool. But yes, that's my fond farewell. And you will be missed.
All the objective room missions. Bye-bye.
Hey, but now you don't have to put those big buildings in the center of the room. Just put them somewhere else where it makes a lot more sense.
They still make damn good terrain.
Yes, sir.
So coming up next week, we will review we had new releases come out.
Mm-hmm.
And one of them may or may not have been the Avatar.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to review our fives. We're going to review the new releases.
Our fives.
For next week. Maybe we'll talk about those cute Halloween-y missions that came out today, mm-hmm. if we remember. We will definitely talk about the unboxing of my copy of Aristea, which will arrive Friday, like the day this comes out, I should be getting it in the mail.
Nice.
So we will definitely be popping that open, talking about the quality of components and mm-hmm. all that, you know, because we played the game.
Yeah.
And did all that. So we know that's good. But yeah, very excited to see the stuff and see how it's presented and like mm-hmm. pop the tokens out of the stuff and do the stuff. And so we'll talk some Aristea next week as well, because we'll have a brand new shiny, oh my God, new
I'm
game
really
smell.
Really stoked about that.
New game smell. I can't wait. So that'll be next week. And that's what we're going to do. Don't forget about fall.
Mm-hmm.
Which is the category for MayaCast MasterGlass Q4. Will you be the last one of 2017 to win a glass with our very metaphysical sort of out there topic for the quarter? And if you're out partying this weekend for Halloween, happy Halloween. Stay safe, be scary. And until next time, support your local game stores. We'll be right back.
find out how you can support the show, go to patreon.com/MayaCast.
You can find us online at www.MayaCast.com.
We are on Facebook at facebook.com/InfinityMayaCast.
Follow at MayaPodcast on Twitter.
Join the MayaCast forum group on Facebook.
And as always, you can email us at tom@MayaCast.com.
And kip@MayaCast.com.